an international lawyer, because I feel as if I ought to paraphrase or misquote the statement made about Elvis and say, Dr. Prince has entered the building. We have been very privileged indeed over the last 2 days to hear two remarkable lectures. Amidst all the toing and froing in the press over Iraq over the last 18 months, 2 years, it's been a really welcome change to hear of the events of these few years in their wider historical context. And it's been really quite remarkable as well for someone so caught up in the maelstrom to be able to speak to us with such a sense of optimism. I think these series of lectures will certainly be looked at by all who are sitting in this lecture hall and in the lecture hall next door, which again is absolutely full. And when they look back in years to come, it will be with the words, I was there. And I think that's a rather nice story. Today's topic, perhaps the most controversial of all, Iraq, the use of force and reform of the United Nations.
Attention that you're devoting my lecture, so I'm tempted to say that I can't wait to hear what I have to say. In my first lecture, I talked about how, especially in the last 150 years, the attitude of the world has changed regarding the use of force between states. In this lecture, I shall focus on the tradition, the radically different attitudes on the use of force, which underlay the Gulf War of 1991 and the Iraq War of 2003. In the post-war World War II philosophy of the Charter of the UN, collective security should be ensured by the Security Council, with its five permanent members carrying the greatest responsibility. Article 2, paragraph 4 of the Charter enshrined the principle that members must refrain from the threat or use of force against the territorial integrity or political independence of any state. And Chapter 7 envisaged for the Security Council to take on behalf of all members upon action, including armed action, in cases of threats to the peace, acts of the peace, or breach of peace, or act of aggression. And as during the long years of the Cold War, effective action was likely to be vetoed by one or several members of the Council, the system of collective security was in practice paralyzed. For that protection against aggression, Article 51 of the Charter left member states to rely, as in the past history, on the inherent right of individual or collective self-defense. With the end of the Cold War, the situation changed. A consensus between the five permanent members of the Council was no longer unlikely. In 1990, it was attained when Iraq attacked and occupied the state of Kuwait. President Bush the Elder built an international coalition of states, including Arab states, and with the authorization of the Security Council, military action was taken in 1991, ousting the Iraqi forces from Kuwait. It was an act of collective self-defense in conformity with the Charter's design. There was euphoria in the UN and the world that the security system of the Charter might now come to function as was envisaged in San Francisco. President Bush the Elder spoke about a new international order. More skeptical commentators noted that the costly collective operation might not have come about if it had not been for the concern that Saddam Hussein, if unchecked, might have pushed on from Kuwait to other oil-rich Gulf states, including Saudi Arabia. There was no guarantee, it was further commented, that a new international order would stop aggression against less strategically important states. And the decision not to use military action to oust Saddam Hussein himself was seen, but rather to stop him before they came to Baghdad, was seen by some skeptics as a calculation to leave in place the Iraqi regime that could balance the theocratic government in Tehran. I described the very intrusive inspection monitoring system yesterday that was imposed on Iraq by the Security Council Resolution 687 in 1991 to ensure that all programs of weapons of mass destruction and their means of delivery were eradicated. Today, we know that the combination of inspection, economic sanctions, and the military and economic pressure worked. As I said, the UN and the world succeeded in disarmament without really knowing it. Only regarding the nuclear program was there a general view among governments that nothing of significance had remained at the end of 1998, when all the inspectors were withdrawn. The IAEA reported in 1997 that it technically coherent picture of the past nuclear had emerged, but cautioned, and I quote ourselves, that some uncertainty was inevitable in any countrywide technical verification process which aims to prove the absence or readily concealable objects and activities. It alluded to the difficulty of proving the negative. I added that the extent to which such uncertainty is acceptable is a policy judgment. It's up to the members of the Security Council and individual governments to decide how much uncertainty will they tolerate. Although both Mr. Ikeas and his successor as executive chairman of UNSCOM, Mr. Butler, expressed the view that most prohibited items related to BNC and missiles had been destroyed, there remained, at the end of 1998, considerable and troublesome uncertainty. Satisfactory evidence could not be found about the destruction of significant quantities of various prohibited weapons items, which Iraq was calculated once to have had. These were then deemed to be unaccounted for. They might indeed have been destroyed or expended in the war with Iran, but until some documentary or other evidence was presented, it could not be excluded that they existed. The suspicions that weapons and other proscribed items were still concealed were strengthened by Iraq's conduct vis-à-vis UN inspectors, especially UNSCOM inspectors, somewhat lesser IAEA inspectors, throughout the 1990s. Denials or delays of access occurred at many sites. Successive so-called full, final, and complete declarations are often inconsistent or patently misleading. After the invasion occupation of Iraq in 2003, when it had become clear that there almost certainly were no prohibited items on any of these sites, the puzzled world asked why Iraq had conducted itself in ways which suggested concealment of items. And from 2002, this conduct was erroneously taken by many as proof of concealment. We can now identify several other possible reasons why they behaved as they did in the 1990s. First, the Iraqi government stated, on the one hand, correctly, that to the UN that all illegal weapons had been destroyed and or declared, and demanded that sanctions would be lifted. However, at the same time, Saddam Hussein wanted to give the impression, not least to Iran, that he might still have weapons of mass destruction. It was a case, as I think I said yesterday, of hanging a sign, you have a dog without having a dog. But secondly, the Iraqi government felt uncertain that sanctions would be lifted, even if they fully cooperated with the inspectors. The U.S. often talked about regime change, and as if fulfilling the demands of the Security Council were not enough. So, if they didn't feel as security that sanctions would be lifted, why bother to cooperate? Obstruction must have been especially tempting when demands or action by inspection teams seemed provocative, as they sometimes were, for attached pride and dignity, as when they wanted to go into ministries or Saddam's palaces. Thirdly, the Iraqi government was aware of the reality that inspector teams could comprise experts who were agents of national intelligence services and felt that such staff might be providing targeting information for bombing. before the terror attacks on the United States on 11 September 2001, and even many months after the attack, leading officials of the U.S. side, including Vice President Cheney, while suspicious of Saddam Hussein, maintained the view that on the whole, Iraq did not constitute a threat to the peace. It was a year after, a number of months after 9/11. However, in tandem with the growing interest in the U.S. administration in regime change in Iraq, the conviction grew, without any new evidence really supporting it, that Iraq did retain weapons of mass destruction and was even resuscitating a nuclear program. Iraqi defectors who wanted to see U.S. armed action ousting Saddam Hussein generously contributed unfounded reports about the existence of proscribed items and programs. The reports were warmly and uncritically received by some governments and intelligence services as supporting the conclusions they wanted to reach. UN inspection authorities did not, on the whole, use defectors as sources. On the 17th of September 2002, the new American National Security Strategy was published, giving support to an argument for possible preemptive actions against terrorist organizations and rogue states, so-called rogue states. In an overview, this National Security Strategy declared, and I quote them, "The U.S. National Security Strategy will be based on a distinctly American internationalism that reflects the union of our values and our national interest. The aim of this strategy is to help the world not just safer, but better." On the legality of preemptive strikes, it had the following to say. For centuries, international law recognized that nations need not suffer an attack before they can lawfully take action to defend themselves against forces that present an imminent danger of attack. Legal scholars and international jurists often condition legitimacy of preemption on the existence of an imminent threat. Now you recall I mentioned the Caroline case where the imminence was the criterion. And they say that it was most often the imminent threat could be seen most often in a visible mobilization of armies, navies, and air forces prepared to attack. And they went on to say, we must adapt the concept of imminent threat or to the capabilities and objectives of today's adversaries. Rogue states and terrorists do not seek to attack or using conventional means. They rely on the use of weapons of mass destruction, weapons that can be easily concealed, delivered covertly, and used without warning. The central message was that the United States has long maintained the option of preemptive action to counter a sufficient threat to our national security. The greater the threat, the greater the risk of inaction, then the more compelling the case for taking anticipatory action to defend ourselves, even if uncertainty remains as to the time and the place of the enemy's attack. To forestall or prevent such hostile acts by our adversaries, the United States will, if necessary, act preemptively. This was the national security document that came in August 2002. The strategy goes on to explain that in order to support preemptive action, the U.S. will, and I quote them again, build better, more integrated intelligence capabilities to provide timely, accurate information on threats wherever they emerge. It was thus realized that if counterattacks were to be made before attacks had occurred, the counterattacks were to take place before the attacks, there would be a crucial need to justify them by accurate information on the threats. It is somewhat ironic to read this line from September 2002, a period when the dominant ambition of the intelligence services of the governments in the US and the UK too was to read available information as supporting the preconceived and erroneous notion of an acute threat. On 24th of September 2002, the UK intelligence dossier was published. In the letter by which it was transmitted to to the president of the Security Council, it was stated that, and I quote them, based on significant amounts of new intelligence, it shows clearly how Iraq has developed chemical and biological weapons, has acquired missiles capable of attacking neighboring countries with these weapons, and has persistently tried to develop a nuclear weapon. Bomb. This was in September 2002. It went on to report that even now, Iraq is still making arrangements to conceal its weapons or mass destruction programs. The foreword to the dossier by Prime Minister Blair contained the by now famous or infamous passage about Iraqi military planning, allowing for, I quote, some of the weapons of mass destruction to be ready within 45 minutes of an order to use them. However, different from the corresponding US dossier that was published at about the same time, the preface made the case, and I quote, that the inspectors must be allowed back in to do their job properly, and that if Saddam refuses, or if he makes it impossible for them to do their job, as he has done in the past, the international community will have to act. So there was a demand for inspection, which was not found in the US dossier. Now, many commentators have expressed the conviction that the war in Iraq was predetermined, that is to say, not decided in March 2003, but sometime in 2002. When the relevant documents come on the table, we shall know. It is true that the US military build-up in the Gulf area began in the summer of 2002 and continued in the fall of 2002. That the US doctrinal support for the preemptive action, as which I quoted, came in the same period, as did statements by leading US policymakers about the need for regime change in Iraq and the uselessness of inspections. On the desirability of inspections, there were clearly differences of opinion between the hawks in the US administration, like Vice President Cheney, and others. It's also clear from the words that I have cited from Prime Minister Blair that while he had doubts that Saddam Hussein would cooperate with inspections, the conclusion he drew from the intelligence dossier was that there was a need for renewed UN inspections. The different views seems to have been bridged in two conclusions. First, that Iraq's weapons of mass destruction would have to be eliminated. And secondly, that the demand for inspections, which both the US and the UK had long supported in the UN, was confirmed, but without much conviction that it would be accepted by Iraq and that inspections could be successful if Iraq indeed accepted them. The same somewhat ambivalent attitude was taken throughout the rest of 2002. In his speech before the General Assembly to the UN on September, President Bush challenged the UN to uphold its resolutions against Iraq, but nowhere did he then mention inspection. When shortly thereafter Iraq accepted inspections, a new Security Council resolution was drafted in Washington, proposing a new kind of armed inspections under the formal direction of the UN, but under the real command of the P5, or the P5 permanent members of the Security Council. Not surprisingly, this approach did not sell in New York. The P10 would not have been happy to go along with it. And after drawn-out negotiations, the Security Council Resolution 1441 was unanimously adopted, and it omitted any reference to the P5. This new resolution gave inspectors explicitly all the rights they could wish for, including the right to bring private Iraqi citizens from their country for interrogations abroad, and the right to perform inspections of presidential sites in the same way as any other site. And you may recall that Kofi Annan had, in 1998, negotiated an agreement, an exchange of notes, under which there would be special procedures for the inspection of presidential sites. This was washed off, and we had the right to perform inspections there in the same way as in any other site. Several specific requests regarding the coming inspections, which I, as Director General of the IAEA, Mohammed El-Baradei, had made in a letter to Iraq after negotiations with them about the way inspections were to take place, and they had been a bit evasive on some things. We sent the letter and said, this is what we want. Now, this letter was generously declared now by the Security Council to be binding on Iraq. And as I noted in my book on inspections, it was the only time in my life that a letter that I had written was elevated to world law. It is possible that some policymakers in Washington hoped that the new resolution would be too bitter a pill for Iraq, that it would be rejected, and that thereby one argument against military action would be removed. However, undoubtedly aware of the continuous military build-up in the Gulf area, Iraq accepted the resolution with some contortions. I doubt that without the build-up, there would have been acceptance. I do not disagree with the view that diplomacy sometimes needs to be backed by significant pressure. The difficulty comes when the pressures do not work and the need presents itself to show that the threats were not empty. Where governments are not sure about their readiness to let action follow threat, they should be careful in calibrating the pressure threats, not to paint themselves into corners. My guess is that in the case of the military pressure on Iraq in the fall of 2002 and the winter of 2003, the US government did not mind going into the corner. Part of the administration was indeed eager to get there as fast as it could. The UK government may well have been a somewhat less enthusiastic comrade on this journey. I need not recount the 3.5 month period of inspections from November 2002 to March 2003, but a few comments may be needed. First, once the inspection started, the practical support, not only from the UK side, but also from the US side, was good. If anything, we were concerned about a too close US embrace. A proposed bilateral understanding how inspections were to be concluded was suggested. More US staff and experts for the inspection teams, people who have not been in our training courses. We needed to preserve the independence which the Security Council had intended for the authority, and we did. Secondly, there was support for the inspections at the practical level, perhaps with some of the advice intended to lead to action which would bring the Iraqis to stall and be guilty of breach of the resolution. At the political level, there was an unmistakable action to conclude as early as possible that Iraq did not cooperate and respect the resolution. The implication of such a conclusion was that time was coming to take armed action. Third, as a number of sites visited and inspections performed increased, in the end about 500 sites and 700 inspections, it became clear that none of the dozens of sites which had been visited among those proposed by intelligence contained any weapons of mass destruction, any smoking guns. This experience and our examination of various pieces of evidence alleged to prove that Iraq retained prohibited items raised doubts in our mind about the reliability of the evidence invoked by the US and UK governments. What our own inspections came up with were some debris from past weapons programs and indications of breaches of the restrictions which Iran had to observe on missile ranges. While access was almost invariably given promptly to sites we wished to visit, our sense was that until about the end of January 2003, the Iraqi side did not make a full effort to clarify the past. We reported our findings and experiences faithfully to the Security Council and to the intelligence services from which we had received tips about sites to visit. And I have little doubt that our reports contributed to influence the majority of the members of the Security Council and indeed of the UN to hold that inspection should continue and that time was not ripe for armed action. I noted that the report of Lord Butler expressed surprise that the UK authorities did not re-evaluate their evidence in the light of what the UN inspectors had reported. Sad to conclude, the progressive decrease in the persuasiveness of the evidence advanced to support armed action was paralleled by a progressively strengthened determination to launch action. Efforts by the UK to make a last-ditch effort for some more inspections failed. After the invasion and its one welcome result, the ousting of Saddam Hussein. It took only a few months until it was understood through U.S. interrogations for Iraqi scientists, military, and administrators that there were no stocks or weapons of mass destruction. In September 2003, David Kaye, as the head of the U.S. appointed Iraq Survey Group, and in October 2004, his successor, Charles Duffer, confirmed this conclusion. I've seen criticism of the UN inspection organization and of myself that we did not present this conclusion, which might have averted the war. The simple answer to the criticism is that while the critical examination which we undertook of all evidence led to the rejection of some of the evidence presented by the US and the UK, and doubts about some other, we could still not exclude that some items unaccounted for existed. While proving the negative would have remained impossible, a few months more of inspections would have been important. They would have enabled the inspectors to visit all sites proposed by intelligence and to find that none of these held weapons of mass destruction. In March 2003, we were not in that position. Before the Iraq War, the continued presence of proscribed items of mass destruction and the acute threat that this constituted was the dominant justification given for the war. I shall come back to that when discussing the permissibility of preemptive attacks. Especially after the war, a number of other explanations of the purpose of the action have been given. Although giving explanations is not necessarily the same as giving justifications, some were presumably given with that purpose and aim. For instance, it had been said that the purpose was to oust the brutal regime, to introduce respect for human rights, and to establish a democracy that could be a model for the Middle East. While it is clear that the ousting of Saddam was a great gain, the practicality of the case of Iraq of establishing democracy and human rights through war and occupation seems dubious. The argument would hardly have persuaded, this is perhaps more important, that the argument would hardly have been persuasive for the US Congress, for the UK Parliament, and the Security Council to support armed action. It has further been argued that the occupation of Iraq was meant to serve as a signal to any regime or group that proliferation or weapons of mass destruction and terrorism would be dealt with firmly. One has to note that it is doubtful whether the action had any influence on Libya, that the problems in Iran and North Korea do not appear to have been alleviated, and that terrorism, if anything, has been stimulated by the occupation of Iraq. Again, on these grounds, authorization for the war would not have been obtained by the UK Parliament and the US Congress, or indeed the Security Council. While these explanations and justifications attract attention in the public debate, the legal justifications offered seem to be relatively little discussed outside the professional worlds of the UN and the law to which the members of this audience probably belong. These arguments appear to have been the same or similar for the US as for the UK. And for the UK, the Attorney General, Lord Goldsmith, has stated that, and I quote him, "The authority to use force against Iraq exists from the combined effects of resolutions 678, 687, and 1441. All of these resolutions," he said, "were adopted under Chapter 7 of the Charter, which allows the use of force for the express purpose of restoring international peace and security." That the Security Council had the authority to give green light to armed action is not in doubt. The question raised is rather whether individual members of the Council could at any time take armed action against Iraq, claiming to be authorized by the Council, even when it was clear that the majority of the Council did not accept or perhaps even oppose such action. In 2002, before Resolution 4041 was adopted, the US maintained it did not need any specific authority to take armed action. After the war, Condoleezza Rice, now Secretary of State of the US, suggested that the states launching the war were, as it wrote, upholding the authority of the council, that those who went to war upheld the authority of the council. The idea, I think, sounds a little bizarre. States which refrain from submitting to a vote a resolution which they knew would not pass, could not pass, would have the authority which they could not get from the council. What would the council opponents, what could they have done? Could they have submitted a resolution prohibiting armed action to be vetoed by some members of the minority in the council? It is intriguing. Further, if the US and UK and other states in the alliance of the willing deemed that they were at liberty, without further explicit authorization by the council, to intervene by force to uphold the authority of the council, presumably one would have to conclude that China, France and Russia and allies of these states could have taken action they deemed appropriate to uphold the same authority. It is hard to avoid the conclusion that a decision by the council as authority was required, and that individual members of the council had no permission slip from 1990-1991 or even 2002. It was argued by the UK Attorney General that Resolution 4041 gave what the resolution termed a final opportunity to comply with his disarmament obligations, and that Iraq did not take it. However, would it not have been for the Council rather than for individual members to judge whether Iraq had taken the opportunity or not? Moreover, how long was the opportunity to be open? No time-specific limit was set in the resolution. The only timeline given regarding inspections was that both UNMOVIC and the IA were to update the Council within 60 days from the resumption of inspections. This reporting date turned out to be the 27th of January, but could have been weeks later if the resumption of inspection were to have been slower than it was. We started inspections earlier than the Council had set as the deadline for them. In February and March 2003, the inspections worked rather well. On the 7th of March, I told the Security Council that, I quote myself, inspection work is moving on and may yield results. This was the 7th of March. It is hard to see any compelling reason for the haste, except that an army of 200,000 men were waiting and that the hot season was coming. In my first lecture, I referred to the discussions in the recent American election campaign and said that both candidates took the view that the U.S. must be able to take preemptive action in certain situations. The difference between them seemed to be that Senator Kerry said that such action would have to stand up to a global test, while President Bush ridiculed any idea of what permissions did from anybody. Now, Article 51 of the UN Charter stipulates that nothing in the Charter impairs the inherent right of individual and collective self-defense if an armed attack occurs against a member of the UN until the Security Council has taken measures necessary to maintain international peace and security. On the face of it, the rule is simple and straightforward. When the attack occurs, you see it and you are fully entitled to act in self-defense. It was written with old-fashioned, straightforward wars in mind. Already during the Cold War, difficulties of interpretation followed from the new types of conflict in the shape of subversive actions and wars by proxy. The possibility that any one of the five great powers could launch sudden and devastating nuclear missile attacks did not speak in favor of a right of anticipatory self-defense, but rather of rapid detection system and the maintenance of a second strike capability as a deterrent. The more recent situations in which less stable attackers, rogue states and terrorist groups might not be sensitive to deterrent retaliatory strikes, this has complicated the situation. The U.S. National Security Strategy, which was written after the 2001 terrorist attacks on the United States, referred to the requirement of off-foot from the 19th century Caroline case that an anticipated attack would have to be imminent to allow preemptive action, and held it to be too rigid. This was a security strategy, I thought. President Bush is quoted as saying that when it is imminent, it is too late. And he has instead referred to a growing danger as sufficient. He has also been quoted as saying that 9/11 was the Pearl Harbor of World War III, the war against terrorism, while President Cheney is quoted as saying that this new war may last generations. Does all this mean that the U.S. now considers itself engaged in a world war in which it feels at liberty to attack anywhere it sees a growing danger? The new Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice, has said that you do not have to wait for a mushroom cloud before you take action in self-defense. Was there an implication that India would have been justified to attack Pakistan's nuclear facilities for the enrichment of uranium before Pakistan tested oil? Was there an implication that Israel had been justified in 1981 to attack and destroy Iraqi research reactor OSIRAQ, an action that was condemned at the time by the Security Council? On that occasion, the U.S. joined the conclusion of the Council, holding that Israel had not exhausted other means to avert the danger it perceived from the reactor. Can one infer from what Dr. Rice said that the United States or Israel today would feel justified to attack uranium nuclear installations for the enrichment of uranium, or that the U.S. would feel entitled to attack today nuclear facilities in North Korea? If the answers to the questions I have put are in the affirmative, would it mean that in the view of the U.S., all states would be entitled to attack, perceiving a growing danger, or is it only the United States? Well, these are troubling questions, and I'm not going to answer them. When looking at the surprise terror attacks on the United States in 2001, all governments will probably maintain that they would see it as their duty to their own population to take action, if need be, even unilateral armed action, to seek to prevent a terror attack that they learned was coming. Like the United States, I think no state in such situation would ask for permission slip from anybody. There are, however, some crucial problems with the claim of a right to such actions in anticipatory self-defense. Before a foreign attack has taken place, the knowledge about it is likely to depend upon intelligence. And the Iraqi affair does not give much confidence about national intelligence as a reliable basis. Well, it turns out that there was no reliable basis, what was meant to be an anticipatory self-defense might become a totally unjustified attack. And I might remind you of another case which was not an anticipatory, but what was a punitive action in after the Al-Qaeda attacks on the embassies, U.S. embassies in Nairobi and in Dar es Salaam. The Clinton administration sent cruise missiles on some targets in Afghanistan, but also on a factory outside Khartoum that intelligence had told them was leaked to Al-Qaeda. It turned out to be erroneous intelligence. So I suppose they lifted their hat and said sorry about that. Although imminence may be a severe time requirement, a growing threat would be an unacceptably lax criterion and would not tally with the general accepted position that force should only be used as a last resort. We evidently need some discussion of these matters in the Global Village Council. And that leads me to the last section in my lecture about UN reform. The results of a review by a panel appointed by the Secretary General Kofi Annan on the functioning of the UN will very soon be on the table. There is no doubt about the need for a wide array of questions to be discussed, but one might wonder whether the intergovernmental discussions would have a chance to be productive at the present time, when the administration of the most powerful member of the organization shows signs of disdain for it. We learned before the armed action in Iraq that in the view of the U.S. administration, the Security Council had the choice of voting with the U.S. for armed action or be irrelevant. The majority of the council did not allow itself to be pushed into supporting the action, and the invasion took place. Many saw this as a loss of prestige for the council and as a crisis for the UN. And in my way, it was and is. The institutions of the UN, like the Security Council, are instruments to be played upon. Important members choose not to play or are completely out of tune with other members, no marching music results. It is only when the construction of the instruments is found deficient or outmoded that the repair of the instrument is meaningful. The refusal of the majority of the Security Council to follow the tune which the US wished the Council to play last year can also be seen as saving the authority and the respectability of the Council. One might ask how the world would have looked upon the Council today if it had endorsed an armed action to eradicate weapons of mass destruction which did not exist, and the evidence of which were often concocted or even forged. Today, most countries and most people in the world consider the armed action launched in Iraq a grave error or worse, and a large part of the US public opinion, perhaps even a majority of the US public opinion, shares this view. Yet the new US administration seems to take the victory in the presidential election not only as sustaining strong positions and actions against terrorist threats, which is probably a justified interpretation, but also as sustaining its decision to launch a war against Iraq and as supporting its current disdain for the UN. It is as if the UN had insulted the US. The Republican Convention nominated President Bush erupted in applause when Vice President said that Mr. Bush would never seek the permission slip to defend the American people. Fine, except that Iraq was not a threat, not a growing threat, and probably not even a distant threat. We also see an intense and large-scale vilification campaign depicting the UN as corrupt, because the Oil for Food program, which was instituted and supervised by the Security Council and its most powerful members, including the US, enabled Iraq, the buyers of Iraqi oil and the sellers of products to Iraq, fraudulently to siphon off money and pass them on illegally to the regime. Whether any corruption is in the real sense of that word occurred within the UN Oil for Food Administration is examined by Mr. Volker. The fraud that Iraq and contracting parties around the world committed, although widely suspected and even asserted in media at the time, to be something in the range of $1 billion per year, was probably not easy for the UN Oil for Food Administration to track down and to prove. It would have taken more of an FBI to do that. The Council and its members saw it with open eyes, just as it saw the billions that flowed to Saddam Hussein from the Iraqi oil exports to neighboring states, to Syria and Turkey. The program functioned, the Oil for Food program, functioned as a reasonably effective break against the import of weapons and of dual use items, which was its major objective. Today, however, it serves as a campaign platform against the UN. So long as the current climate remains, it is doubtful whether any meaningful discussion about UN reform can be pursued. There is something paradoxical about the current crisis of the UN and the criticism of the Security Council as a talk shop. We did not hear this during the long years of the Cold War, when the Council was habitually prevented from action by the threat or use of Soviet vetoes. There are no automatic Russian and Chinese obstacles to Council action today. Large numbers of peacekeeping operations were started in the first period of the Entente, and to be fair, not so few decisions are still taken by consensus in the Council. Yet, the atmosphere currently remains poisoned. It has been suggested that in the review of the functioning of the UN, an effort should be made to examine the circumstances in which the use of force can and should be authorized. Some would wish to see a greater use of the power of the Council to hold members to their duties to protect their own citizens, to to intervene by force, if necessary, in situations of genocide as in Rwanda and Darfur. Others want to search for a reformulation of Article 51 of the Charter to give some room for preemptive action. I'm not optimistic about Charter amendments in either case, nor am I sure that it really is needed. Many members will remain skeptical about any international armed interventions at all. They are suspicious of any outside interference, even by the UN, for the purpose of upholding human rights. Other members may not be persuaded to spend resources or risk the lives of their soldiers unless significant national interests are at stake, as they were in the Gulf War in 1991 and perceived to be in Iraq in the War of 2003. Where intervention will be justified as the only way to prevent grave violation of the human rights and acceptable to a broad membership, I do not think that the rule in the Charter 2.7, Article 2.7 about matters incidentally within domestic jurisdiction will stand off the way of action. I further think it's unlikely that any agreed language could be found explicitly allowing members to use force preemptively or preventively without the authorization of the Security Council. It is more likely that an answer, I think, to the problem will slowly emerge through precedents. It is also important, as Kofi Annan has noted, that the Security Council actively consider and monitor threats posed by possible weapons of mass destruction, giving all the members of the Council the feeling that the issue is taken seriously and that there is a readiness to take joint action where there is convincing evidence for a threat that is significant and near in time. I will end by saying that the Security Council remains potentially a vital institution. The Iraq War demonstrated the handicap which followed from not acting with its authorization. It was said that it would make itself irrelevant, but it was found after the war that there are considerable handicaps in not having achieved or obtained that authorization. The Council would have even greater authority if its composition were modified. In 1945, power was the military power of the victor states. However, when economic sanctions and pressures are to be applied, which is preferable to the application of force, there is an advantage in the presence in the Council of states with much economic power. For greater legitimacy, the Council also needs to represent a large part of the world's population. Hence, a need for the presence in the Council of the most populous countries in all continents. One argument, lastly, not infrequently advanced, I find totally unacceptable, that those rich states which pay the greatest contributions to the UN budget should merit a seat on the Council. In my view, it should not be possible to buy a seat in the Security Council.